cần không? Thank you. Okay, good evening everyone. I am Riya Tapwal. I am doing PhD at IIT Kharagpur under the supervision of Professor Sudeep Mishra, and today we are going to discuss the topic of week 9, and after that we will discuss some questions. So last week we were discussing about cloud computing. Today we are going to continue that topic only. So first of all, we are going to discuss about OpenStack. So OpenStack is a free open standard cloud computing platform that first came into existence in July 21, 2010. It was a project of Rackspace Hosting and NASA to make cloud computing more ubiquitous in nature. It was deployed as a infrastructure as a service in both cloud in both public and private clouds, where virtual resources are made available to the user. The software platform contains interrelated components that control multi-vendor hardware pools of processing, storage, networking resources, and data in center. Basically, various companies like IBM, Cisco, HP, Dell, VMware, Red Hat, SUSE, Rackspace are using these are contributing to OpenStack. It has a very large community and it can be used to develop private or public, both type of cloud. Unlike virtualization, in which such as various resources, RAM, CPU are abstracted from the hardware using hypervisor, OpenStack uses number of APIs to abstract those resources so that the user and the administrator are able to directly interact with the cloud service. Various versions of OpenStack are available. So initially Austin was 12, then Vexer, Cactus, Diablo. So in this way, in 2022, Z. So from A to Z was introduced. After that, again starting with A, then now the recent one is Antelope, which was developed in 2023, and now Caracal is the next is the newest one, whose release date is April 3rd 2024. However, it is not developed yet, it is in the maintenance phase. So once it is developed, it will be available to all. Now apart from these various kind of versions, then we are going to discuss the components of OpenStack. So OpenStack, there are majorly 9 components or services which are there in OpenStack. These are, first one is Origin, then Nova, Glance, Swift, Neutron, Schindler, Heat, Seriometer, and Keystone. Now we are going to discuss about these components one by one. So first component is Keystone. So Keystone is used to provide identity as a service to the end user. With the help of this, OpenStack can provide authentication and authorization to various kind of users which are present. So it is responsible for all type of authentication and authorization. It is a directory based service that uses central repository to map the correct services with the user. Next component is Origin. So Origin is responsible for providing web based interface for OpenStack services. It is used to manage, provision, and monitor the cloud resources. It, as I told you, that it provides interface, so it is a GUI of the software with the help of which you can get the overview of other components. Next component is Swift. Swift, it is the object storage service with high fault tolerance capability, and it used to retrieve unstructured data objects with the help of APIs. So it is distributed platform, so it also used to provide redundant storage within server that are clustered together. Next component is Nova. So Nova is responsible for managing the compute resources like creating, deleting, handling the scheduling, it can be seen as a program dedicated to automation of resources that are responsible for virtualization of services and high performance computing. Next component is GLANS, which is responsible for registering, storing, and retrieving the virtual disk images from the complete network. These images are stored in wide range of backend systems. Next component is Neutron, which is responsible for connecting all the network across the OpenStack. It is an API driven service that manages all the networks and IP addresses. So with the help of Neutron, you can make your own network. Next component is Shinder, which is responsible for providing persistent block storage that is made accessible using API. Now there are two types of storage services. One is your Shinder, which is responsible for block storage, and other one is your Swift, which is responsible for your object storage. Now the next one is Heat, which is used for on-demand service provisioning with auto scaling of cloud resources. It works in coordination with the Celiometer in order to provide the orchestration between different components. And last one is Celiometer, which is responsible for metering and billing of all the services which are used by the end user. It is used to generate alarms when a certain threshold is exceeded. So basically, Celiometer keeps the record of all the services which you are using, for how long you are using, and depending upon that, it is going to create the bills. Apart from that, OpenStack has various features. For example, it is modular in architecture, so that enable user to deploy only the components which they want. Then multi-tenancy, similar to cloud, here one resource can be used by multiple. Open source, that we have already discussed. Distributed, we have already discussed that the data or the services can are present redundantly over different components. And then it is API driven. Now the next topic is sensor cloud. So in case of sensor, as we have discussed two different topics. First one is sensors. So sensors are the components which are used to sense the environment and give the feedback. And cloud is the different technology which we discussed. So basically, cloud provide a pool of resources and services to the end users. Now, by combining these two terms, that is sensor and cloud, there is one third term which was introduced, that is sensor cloud. So sensor cloud is not mere integration of sensor and cloud computing. So sensor cloud does not mean that you are integrating or synerging between the sensor and cloud computing. It is not only the dumping sensor data into cloud. So sensor cloud does not mean that you are taking the data from your sensors and storing it into the cloud. However, here sensor cloud means virtualization of sensor nodes. So basically, the concept, for example, in case of cloud computing, what happened is different types of resources are there which are virtualized and used by different end users. So same concept was taken. So in case of sensor cloud, various virtualized scenario of a sensors are developed so that end user can use them. So it is also as similar to cloud computing, it is pay per use. So the number of sensors and the type of sensors the end user are going to use, accordingly they have to pay for them. One sensor appears as many. And this is what I have told, that here the virtualization of sensor is done, due to which a single resource appears to be many resources and used by different end users for different purposes. A stratum between sensor node and end user is there in sensor cloud. So here in this figure, it is showing that sensor cloud does not mean simply the integration, and it does not mean taking the data from the sensors and sending it to the cloud. However, sensor cloud means virtualizing the sensors and providing same sensor to different users at the same time. Now, one computer host appears as many computer. Concept of virtual machine is used in sensor cloud. It improved the throughput and cost by using physical resources as a pool from which virtual resources can be allocated. So similar to cloud computing, here the pool of instead of resources, here resources are sensors. So pool of resources is there. These resources are virtualized. Basically, sensors are virtualized and allocated to different users. Now the benefits. So first one is sharing of resources. So same resources can be used by different end users for different applications, and in return they have to pay for those resources. Second one is encapsulation. A complete computing environment is provided. Then independence, run independently of underlying hardware, and then portability. So a virtual machine migration is also there here. Now here we are going to discuss about the traditional wireless sensor network and sensor cloud in terms of different attributes. So first attribute is ownership. So in case of WSN, only the user is the owner. However, in case of sensor cloud, the one who is owning the sensor is the owner. Then deployment of a WSN is done by the user only. And in case of sensor cloud, the owner are going to deploy the sensors in different locations. Then redeployment in case of WSN is done by the WSN users. However, in case of sensor cloud, the redeployment is done by the CSP. Then the maintenance in case of WSN is done by the WSN user. However, maintenance in sensor cloud is provided by SCSP. SCSP is the sensor cloud service provider. Okay. And then next is overhead. So overhead in case of WSN is handled by WSN user only. However, in case of sensor cloud, it is SCSP. Then usage. So basically, the end users are only going to use the WSN sensors. In case of sensor cloud, end users are different whose applications wants to use the sensors. So for example, there I am sensor owner, right? I have some temperature sensor which I have deployed in IIT KGP campus. Now there are two different end users who want to use those temperature sensors for their different application. So one application may be to get the temperature of the campus, and other application may be to check whether due to this temperature how the humidity is changing or some other thing. So different end users with different applications can use the sensor which is deployed by me in order to perform their applications. Now I own those sensor, I deployed those sensor. Now the management part is done by the service computing sorry sensor cloud service provider, and end users are going to use them. However, in case of traditional wireless sensor networks, I am the only one who is going to deploy the sensor. I am the only one who is going to manage it, and I am the only one who is going to use the application of those sensors. Now this figure is showing the difference between the sensor cloud and the WSN. So first figure, this figure is of WSN. So in case of WSN, various sensors are deployed, and the data which is sensed by those sensor is aggregated and sent to the WSN user. However, in case of sensor cloud, various sensors are deployed. Now end users does not know that exactly from which sensor they are getting the data, first thing, and also they do not know whether these same data is used by the other end users as well. So here you can see that there are multiple applications or multiple users who are going to use the same set of sensor, and they do not know whether these are used by the other applications as well. Now the actors of sensor cloud, actors mean different components which are there. So first one is end users. So they are unknown about what and which physical sensor are allocated to serve the application. This is what I have told you, that here the end user does not do not know that which sensor is deployed for them and which sensor they are using. Then sensor owners, so they play a role from business perspective. They purchase physical sensor, deploy them, and lend these devices to the sensor cloud. Now the third actor is a sensor cloud service provider. So these are the business actors which are responsible for the management of these sensors. They charge prices from the end user as per the usage of sensor as a service. Some example of sensor cloud service provider includes AWS IoT, Microsoft Azure IoT, Google Cloud IoT, and IBM Watson IoT. Now the architecture of sensor cloud. So this figure is showing the architecture. So there are basically three main layers. So first layer is the sensor layer, where physical devices are deployed, various physical sensor nodes are deployed. Second layer is the virtualization layer, where different services like pricing, virtualization, management, composition, caching, database, these are managed by your sensor cloud service provider. And third layer is the interface layer, with the help of which end users are going to use the sensors which are deployed. So here end users register themselves, select templates with the help of which they want to access the physical resources, and then request for the application. Sensor owners deploy heterogeneous or homogeneous physical sensor nodes over different geographical location, and SCSP plays the managerial role. Basically, this SCSP is responsible for the management of different services which are there. Now, management issues in sensor cloud. So first one is optimal composition of virtual sensor node. Now for an application, it does not mean that it is going to use only a single sensor, right? Now what will be the optimal composition, that which set of sensors particular application should use, how many sensors should be there in that particular set of virtual sensors. Okay, so this is one major challenge, that how a particular virtual sensor should be made from the physical resources sensor. Now for example, consider an industrial scenario where you want to check the health of your machine, whether your machine is working fine or not. Okay, so for that only single sensor cannot provide you the better idea whether the machine is working fine or not. So in that case, you have to use multiple sensors, for example vibration sensor, accelerometer, power sensor, then your temperature sensor, humidity sensor. So these are the various kind of sensor that you need in order to check whether your machine is working fine or not. So in this case, what should be the optimal composition, that which kind of resources we need in order to check whether your machine is fine. So we need five types of sensors. So in that case, your virtual sensor will consist of five different physical sensors. Okay, the second thing is how many. One is the type, the second is how many sensors should be there in one virtual sensor. Second one is data caching. So where exactly you need to cache the data so that the end user can easily access that. And third one is the optimal pricing, so that both the end users are satisfied with the services and your sensor owner and SCSP get enough advantage or profit from the deployment of sensors. Now this is the two different views of sensor cloud. First one is the user organization view and second one is the real view. So from the user perspective, what happened is there are different applications which are used by the end users. They want to use the sensors. So first of all, they have to log in with the help in a user organization. They have to log in using the credential and they have to select the template, and in that for a particular format they are going to use the resources. They don't know that they are going to use the sensor, they don't know that which kind of sensors are there, they don't know about the different kind of scheduling which is taking place. They only know that, yeah, we have, okay, I have to log in and I have to use this particular application in this format. This is the end user point of view. But in actual, what happened is, this is a web portal with the help of which the applications or end users will log in. After that, in the virtualization layer, various kind of management services are there. For example, dynamic scaling, on-demand physical census scheduling, vast data storage and specialized processing, then energy management. All these things take place. And after that, this management layer interact with the actual resource pool of sensors, which interacts with this layer and provide the data to the end user. Now, virtual sensor. So, efficient virtualization of physical sensor nodes is there. An optimal composition of virtual sensor is required. Consider same geographical region in this first case. Okay. So, there might be a case that only a same geographical region you are going to use the virtual sensor. However, in the second case, there might be case that your sensors are located on different geographical regions. So first is formation of virtual sensor according to COV1. So optimal formation of virtual sensor is required. In case of first case, only the homogeneous sensors are used within the same geographical boundary. However, in this case, a virtual sensor is formed by different kind of heterogeneous sensors which are present in different locations. So virtual sensor can be created by using homogeneous sensors as well as heterogeneous sensor. There might be the case that all the homogeneous sensors are present in the same geographical region. There might be the case that these are present in the different geographical region. Now, why the composition of virtual sensor is required? Because first one is resource constrained sensor node. So only a single sensor node cannot provide you the sufficient service which the end user needs. So due to its resource constrained nature. So that's why a set of sensors are required in order to provide a service to the end user. Second is dynamic change in sensor condition is there. So for example, if your one sensor become faulty, then other sensors are going to tackle that problem. So in that case, you are going to get exact a result. However, if you are going to use only a single sensor and it become faulty, then you do not know whether the data which you are getting is correct or not. And the third one is the composition of virtual sensors are non-traditional. Now, dynamic and adaptive caching mechanism. So it introduces internal and external caching mechanism which ensures efficiency in resource utilization. It is flexible with the varied rate of change of physical environment. Now, why caching in sensor node? So end user request for the sensed information through web interfaces. Allocation of physical sensor nodes and virtualization take place. Physical sensor nodes continuously sense and transmit data to sensor cloud. Practically, in some cases, the change in environmental condition are significantly slow. Due to the slow change in environment, the sensed data remain unaltered. And in such scenario, if for a long time your sensed data become unaltered, then continuously sending data results in energy consumption. So in order to prevent that, we store that data near to the end user and use that particular data for the time till the there is any change in the exact data which is sensed by the sensors. Now, two types of caching is there. First one is internal caching. So it handles the request from the end user. It takes decisions whether the data should be provided directly to the end user or is it required to recache the data from the external cache. Second one is external cache. So after every certain interval of data, it is required to recache. Initially, few data are used to be transmitted to internal cache. So this figure is differentiating between no caching mechanism and caching enabled architecture. So here, without caching, Every time your application needs data, we have to fetch the data from the sensor, send it to the sensor cloud, and then sensor cloud is responsible for sending the data to the application. Now, in this scenario, your sensors are active continuously, right? So this results in the consumption of their resources. For example, this sensor wants to send data, so it's not like that it can directly send the data. We have we already discussed that sensor first send the data to the next sensor, then to the next sensor, and in this way the data is sent. Now for sending the data, their resources are utilized. Now consider the case that the sensors are generating same data because the environment is not changing. So it's better to store that particular data somewhere near to the application. So it will prevent the delay as well as prevent the resources consumption as well. So that's why cache-enabled architecture was introduced, where two types of caching mechanisms are there. First one is internal cache and second is the external cache. So external cache contains the data which is there, which is sensed by the sensors. After regular interval of time, the data is updated here, and internal cache provides the data to different applications, and it also decides that whether the data is outdated or not, whether we need the fresh data or not. So it can decide accordingly. Now the next topic is dynamic optimal pricing for sensor cloud infrastructure. So existing scheme consider the homogeneity of services, for example, infrastructure as a service or software as a service. There is no scheme for sensor as a service. The proposed pricing scheme comprises of two components. First one is pricing attribute attributed to hardware and pricing attributed to the infrastructure. So goal of the proposed pricing scheme is to maximize the profit of service provider, to maximize the profit of sensor owner, and to improve the user satisfaction. So the main focus is on maximizing the profit made by the service provider, optimal pricing to the end user, and at the end there should be satisfaction of the end user. So pricing attributed to hardware deals with the usage of physical sensor nodes. However, pricing attributed to infrastructure deals with the prices associated with the infrastructure of the sensor node. Now this figure is showing that how the data is sensed and pricing and negotiation take place. Basically, the sensor owners are going to deploy their sensors. Now the data which is sensed by the sensors is sent to the sensor cloud through base station. This sensor cloud is responsible for the pricing and negotiation between the end users and the sensor owners. Now the aim is to improve the profit of the sensor owners, service provider, and maximizing the user satisfaction. Now the next topic is fog computing. So similar to cloud computing, the aim of the fog computing is to provide services to the end user. However, fog is the layer which is near to the devices. So fog computing or fogging is a term which is coined by Cisco. The idea of fog computing is to extend the cloud nearer to the IoT devices. The primary aim is to solve the problems faced by the cloud computing during the IoT processing. Now, consider that you are generating data here in Kolkata. Your cloud server is present somewhere in America. You want to send the data first. The data is sent from Kolkata to America. The processing will take place there, and then the results are fetched from there. So now the delay in this case is quite high. So in order to prevent that, we are going to place some server which is near to the end users, right? So this fog computing is the layer which is responsible for bringing the services which are provided by the cloud nearer to the end users. Yeah, so 40% of whole world's data came from sensors alone by 2020, and 90% of the world's data were generated only during the period of last 2 years. So these figures or these values are taken in 2020, so these are not current values. So 2.5 quintillion bytes of data is generated per day. Total expenditure of IoT devices will be $1.7 trillion by 2020, and the total number of connected vehicle worldwide will be 250 million by 2020. So these are the values which are for 2020. Now it's even more. So there will be more than 30 billions of IoT devices, and the amount of data generated by IoT devices is simply huge. So this is the main point. The last one, that the data which is produced by IoT devices, because nowadays everywhere there is IoT device, and the data which is generated by the IoT devices are simply huge. So in order to manage that huge amount of data in real time is difficult. So that's why fog layer was introduced. So now, why fog computing? So the ability of the current cloud model is insufficient to handle the requirements of IoT. Issues are volume, latency, and bandwidth. So by 2020, about 50 billion of devices were online. Presently, billions of devices produce exabytes of data every day. Device density is still increasing every day. The current cloud model is enabled to process this amount of data. Private firms, factories, airplane companies produces clueless amount of data every day. And current cloud model cannot store all these data. Data need to be filtered. So this is one of the need why you require fog computing, because the data which is produced by different industries is very huge, and only single cloud computing is unable to handle that. Second is latency. As I have already discussed, that consider that user is somewhere in India and your server is present somewhere in America, so the time to send the data and time to get the result, so it introduces a huge delay. So time taken by the data packet for round trip means sending the data here from here to the cloud server, and from getting the result from the cloud server to back to the end user. So that is the round trip time. An important aspects for handling a time sensitive data is there. If edge devices send time sensitive data to cloud for analysis and wait for the cloud to give proper action, then it can lead to many unwanted results. Consider autonomous vehicle. Okay, so where there is no driver. Now in that case, you need the analysis of data in real time. And if you are sending your data to cloud, which is present somewhere far from the vehicle, then the time in order to process the data and getting back the result is high. So it will increase the chances of accidents. So in order to prevent that, there is a need to process the data somewhere near to the end devices. So while handling the time sensitive data, a millisecond can make a huge difference, as I have told you, because if you are sending the data, it might result in accidents as well. Sending time sensitive data to cloud for analysis. So this is the latency which it is showing, that T time from a device to the cloud, then analysis time, and then cloud from to the device. So the total time involved is, first you are going to send the data to the cloud, there some processing or analytics will take place and you are again fetching the result. So three types of times are involved: sending the data, time for sending the data, time for processing, and time for getting the data. So the overall latency will be increased. So when the action reaches the device, accident may already have been occurred. Now the third one is bandwidth. Now if you are sending huge amount of data to such far place, then it requires huge bandwidth as well, right? So bitrate of data during transmission is bandwidth. If all the data generated by IoT devices are sent to cloud for storage and analysis, then the traffic generated by these devices will be simply gigantic. It consumes almost all the bandwidth. Handling this kind of traffic will simply a very hard task. Billion of devices consuming bandwidth. If all the devices become online, even IPv6 will not be able to provide the facilities to all the devices. Data may be confidential, which the firms do not want to share online. So in this case, fog computing is a solution. Now the requirement of IoT. So first requirement of IoT is to reduce the latency of the data. So appropriate action at the right time prevents major accidents, machine failures, etc. A minute delay while taking decisions make a huge difference. Latency can be reduced by analyzing the data close to the data source. Second is data security. IoT data must be secured and protected from the intruders. Data are required to be monitored 24/7, and appropriate action should be taken before the attack causes major harm to the network. Next requirement is operation reliability. The data generated by IoT devices are used to solve real-time problems. Integrity and availability of data must be guaranteed, and unavailability and tampering of data can be hazardous. So processing of data at respective suitable place is needed. Extremely time sensitive data should be analyzed very near to the data source, and data which are not time sensitive will be analyzed in the cloud. Next is monitor data across large geographical area. So the location of connected IoT devices are can be spread across the large geographical region. For example, monitoring of railway track of a country or a state. The devices are exposed to harsh environment condition. So in this case, because different environment is there in different parts of country, so there is a need to analyze the data locally, so that these environmental condition does not affect the analysis. So when should be used cloud? If the data should be analyzed with a fraction of time, if the data is huge, if there is huge number of devices, if the devices are separated by large geographical distances, if the devices are needed to be subjected to extreme condition. Now this is the architecture of fog computing. So this device, this figure is showing that there are three layers. First one is end user layer, where various IoT devices are deployed. Then the second layer is the fog layer, where fog devices are deployed, and then the cloud layer. So all the time sensitive applications data are analyzed at the fog layer, and the data which is not time sensitive is sent to the cloud for analysis and storage. Now cloud services are extended to IoT devices through fog. Fog is a layer which is placed between the cloud and the IoT devices. Sensor data are processed in the fog before it is sent to the cloud, which reduces the latency and save bandwidth and save the storage of the cloud. So basically some processing is done here, due to which we are not sending the complete data to the cloud, which results in preventing the bandwidth use and save the storage at the cloud as well. Now the characteristics of fog nodes. So storage, so fog nodes only provide transient storage, not permanent storage. So basically only the data which is important and required time sensitive is stored in the fog. The computing facility is there. Fog node should be able to provide some processing to process the data before it is sent to the cloud, to take quick decisions, and there must be network connectivity so that the fog devices can connect to the IoT devices and to the other fog nodes as well as to the cloud. Now fog nodes can be routers, embedded servers, switches, etc., deployable anywhere inside the network. Each fog node have their aggregated fog node. Now working of fog. So there are three types of data. First one is very time sensitive data, which need to be processed within a fraction of time. Then less time sensitive data, which may handle some delay, and the data which is not time sensitive at all. So fog nodes work according to the type of data they are receiving. An IoT application should be installed to each fog node. The nearest fog node ingests the data from the devices. So So first of all, most time sensitive data, so data which should be analyzed within a fraction of second, that should be analyzed nearest to the node itself, and it will send the decision or action to the devices, and it will stores and send the summary of to the cloud for future analysis. Now the data which is less time sensitive, so the data which can be analyzed after seconds or minutes are sent to the aggregated node for analysis. After analysis, the aggregated node send the decision or action to the device through the nearest node, and further it send the summary to the cloud for storage. Now the data which is not time sensitive at all and can wait for hours or days is sent to the cloud, and the analysis and storage of that data is done at the cloud. Now this table is showing the difference between different kind of fog nodes and cloud. So the fog node which are closest to the devices, so for these the analysis duration is fraction of second, and fog aggregate node the analysis duration is seconds to minute, and for cloud it is hours to weeks. After that, the IoT data duration for fog node nearest to the devices is transient. For fog aggregated nodes, it's for hours to days, and for cloud, it is for months to years. Geographical coverage for fog node nearest to the devices is very local. Then fog aggregated node is wider, and for cloud, it is global. Now the example, the most suitable example here is the online shopping websites. Okay, so for consider Amazon. Now I am in Kharagpur, so my preference, my taste regarding clothes or anything else will depending upon the environment or the culture where I am living. Someone who is living in Gujarat, their style of dressing is different from the one which I wore. Okay, so the data which is stored in there is different from the data which is stored here, because the Amazon server which is placed here somewhere in Kolkata should store the data which is similar to the taste of the people of Kolkata. However, the server which is placed in the Kolkata should contain the data which is local to that place. Now the aggregated node or aggregated fog node is the node which is placed in India. Okay, so the fog aggregated node which is placed in India, anywhere, for example in Delhi, will contain the data of all the states, and the main server which is present somewhere in America should contain the data of all the nations. So it might not be the case, it is only present in America. The cloud nodes, as we know, is distributed everywhere. Now the advantages of fog. First one is security. So it fog provides better security. Fog nodes can use same security policy. Second one is low operation cost. So data are processed in the fog nodes before sending to the cloud and reduces the bandwidth consumption. Third one is it reduces the unwanted accidents. So latency will reduce during decision making. Quick decision making is there. Fourth one is better privacy. So every industry can analyze their data locally, store confidential data in their local server, and send only those data which can be shared to the cloud. Then next one is business agility. So fog application can be easily developed according to the tools available, can be deployed anywhere we need, and can be programmed according to the customer's need. The next is support mobility. So nodes can be mobile, nodes can join and leave the network anytime. And next one is deployable in remote places. So it can be deployed in remote places, can be subjected to harsh environment conditions, overseas, railway tracks, vehicle, factory floor, etc. Then next one is better data handling. So it can operate with less bandwidth, data can be analyzed locally, and reduces the risk of latency. Now the applications of fog. So for real-time health analysis, so patient with chronic illness can be monitored in real time. Stroke patients can be monitored, analyze the data in real time. During emergency alerts, the respective doctors immediately. Historical data analysis can predict the future danger that are for patients. And the next one is intelligence, power efficient system. So power efficient in power efficient system for computing can be used. Then reports detail power consumption, report every day, suggest economical power usage plan. The next one is real-time windmill and turbine analysis. You can use fog. Then for real-time rail monitoring, because as we have discussed that railway tracks are spreaded all over the country, and due to different environmental condition, it become difficult for a single server to analyze all the data which is sensed by different sensors which are distributed all over the country. So local processing is required here. Then the next one is pipeline optimization. So for pipeline optimization, you can use fog. Now the challenges. So first challenge is power consumption, because here different fog nodes are deployed. These fog nodes need power, so power consumption is there. Then the data security, because your fog nodes are not that much powerful as the cloud servers, so there might be a risk of attacks over the data which is present in the fog nodes. Then reliability, maintaining data integrity and availability for millions of nodes is difficult. Then fault tolerance should be immediate and fixed. Then programming architecture, since fog nodes may be mobile, so in order to handle their mobility, there should be a proper programming architecture, which is difficult to do. Next one is real-time analysis. So real-time analysis is the primary requirement for minimizing the latency. Dynamic analysis and decision making reduces the danger and increases the output. It monitor huge number of node, monitoring huge number of nodes is not easy. Okay, before question, the next type of technology or the layer which is introduced is edge layer or edge computing. So as we discussed that fog layer is placed somewhere between the end users and the cloud. Now edge layer is the another layer which is introduced and placed over the end devices. So basically there is one more layer which is placed between the fog and the end users. So in case of edge computing, computation take place at the devices network, which is known which is known as edge computing. That means the computer is connected with the network of devices which processes the data and sends the data to the cloud in real time. That computer is known as edge computer. With this technology, data is processed and transmitted to the devices instantly. So this is it. Now the questions, but before question, let's take a break. After that, I'll start.
Hello.
questions. First question is, OpenStack is proprietary and closed source software that you have to pay and buy. True or false? Anyone?
False.
Okay, anyone else?
False.
Right, this option is false because OpenStack is an open source and it requires no payment. Next question is, in OpenStack, which of the following component take care of user authentication? Options are Nova, Origin, Keystone, none of these.
Keystone.
Obviously.
Okay, anyone else?
Keystone.
Keystone.
Right, Keystone is correct. Next question is, you cannot ping your OpenStack instance from an outside network unless you connect your instance with the public network through a blank. Options are router, firewall, repeater, load balancer.
Router.
Anyone else? Anyone else? Correct option is router. Next question is, what is the primary service model for sensor cloud? Options are hardware as a service, platform as a service, data as a service, sensor as a service.
Sensor as a service.
Anyone else?
Option D one.
Right, option D is correct. Sensor as a service. Next question is, you can run two logical computer, one Linux machine and one Windows machine on top of the same physical hardware through the use of blank. Options are sharing, scaling, virtualization, inheritance.
So this
Okay.
virtualization.
Okay, anyone else? Yeah, correct option for this is virtualization. Next question is, in sensor cloud, one physical sensor can be abstracted as multiple virtual sensors. True or false?
True.
Anyone else? Yes, it is true. Now, if I say like in sensor cloud, multiple physical sensors can be abstracted as single virtual sensor. Will it be true or false? Anyone? Now the question is, in sensor cloud, multiple physical sensors can be abstracted as single virtual sensor.
False.
False. Anyone else?
Truman.
Right, it will be true because I told you that we can make a single virtual sensor by considering different kind of heterogeneous sensor which can be present in different geographical regions. So both you can use a single physical sensor as a multiple virtual sensor. On the other hand, you can use multiple physical sensor as a single virtual sensor. So both will be true. Next question is, in a sensor cloud framework, the end users have to continuously worry about owning and managing the physical sensor devices. True or false?
False.
Anyone else?
False.
Right, it is false because your service provider is responsible for managing. Next question is, virtual sensors within the sensor cloud have communication interfaces with blank. Options are only with the physical sensors below them, only the end user applications above them, both physical sensor below and application above, neither the physical sensor nor the applications above.
Option C.
Okay, anyone else? Anyone else? Simple question. Yes, it is option C. Basically, your virtual sensor should be able to communicate with the physical sensor, so only then they can get the data, because in actual only the physical sensors are the those which are going to sense the data, right? And virtual sensor should also be able to interact with the application, otherwise how these applications are going to use that data. So virtual sensor should be able to communicate with both the physical sensor and the application. Which of the following is true? First is traditional WSN, there is a virtualization support. In sensor cloud, there is virtualization support. B, traditional WSN, no virtualization. Sensor cloud, virtualization. C is traditional WSN, there is virtualization. In sensor cloud, there is no virtualization. D is traditional WSN, no virtualization. Sensor cloud, no virtualization.
Option B.
Option D. That is
B.
Okay. Yes, option B is correct, because in traditional WSN there is no virtualization, and in sensor cloud there is virtualization. Next question is, an organization ABC wishes to have environmental monitoring parameters of a particular region, but does not have resources to deploy its own physical sensors. However, another organization has some physical sensors that monitor the environment deployed in that region. Can sensor cloud help in achieving A's objective? True or false?
Yes.
Anyone else?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, so sensor cloud can provide virtual sensor services to A. Next question is, referring back to question number 10, and based on your answer, determine the role that organization A and B play in the given scenario. Option A is a sensor owner, B is a end user. According to option B, A is end user and B is sensor owner. C, both A and B are sensor owner. D, both A and B are end user.
Option A.
Option A is a sensor owner and B is a end user.
Option B.
Okay, let's read the statement again. An organization ABC, okay, let's read from here. However, another organization B has some physical sensors. So basically
Option
A want to use the resources and B has the physical resources. So B is the sensor owner and A
option
is the end user. So option B is correct. Next question is, which among the following is a limitation of cloud computing? Options are on-demand services, virtualization orchestration, large number of computing and storage resources, additional communication latency for critical application.
Option D.
Okay, anyone else? Anyone else? Limitation of cloud computing. First one is on-demand services. Second is virtualization orchestration. Third is large amount of computing and storage resources. Fourth is additional communication latency for critical application. Yeah, correct option is D, because cloud computing, there is latency in order to send the data to the cloud, to process it and to fetch the data, because the distance between the end user and the cloud server is large. Next question is, in fog computing, the fog layer act as intermediary between the data source and the cloud for immediate processing of critical data. True or false?
True.
Anyone else?
True.
Right, this statement is true. Next question is, suppose the one-way communication latency from a device to fog layer is 20 milliseconds and that from the device to the cloud layer is 50 milliseconds. Data processing time at fog is 10 milliseconds and at that cloud is 5 milliseconds. after which a reply is sent back to the device by the fog or cloud. What is the difference between the total communication latency, basically two-way round trip time plus the processing time at cloud or fog, between the devices and the cloud and fog respectively? Options are 50 milliseconds, 60 milliseconds, 55 milliseconds, 100 milliseconds. Take your copy and pen and calculate. You can do orally as well because the terms are not that much big. Okay, anyone else? Anyone else? So for cloud, time taken to send the data, processing time, plus time to get the result. Similar for fog as well, time to send the data to the fog, processing time at fog, and time to get back the data. You will get two values, subtract the one which you get for cloud, basically subtract the fog with the cloud.
The device and the cloud.
What? Can you please repeat? Okay. Now, okay, let's do it. First we'll do for cloud. So time to send the data to the cloud layer is 50 ms. Okay, so 50 millisecond plus processing time at cloud is 5 millisecond. Now if you to send the data is 50, then in order to get the data is also 50, so 50 plus 50 is 100 plus 5 millisecond. So for cloud it is 105 millisecond. Now for fog it is 20 plus 10, 20 plus 10 is 30, then again 10, 20, that is 50. So 105 minus 50 is 55. So correct option for this is 55. Next question is, which among the following is true? Fog computing act as a complement to cloud computing. Fog computing is a replacement for cloud computing. Fog computing and cloud computing are the same. Fog computing is more powerful than cloud computing with respect to resources.
Option A.
Option A. Okay, anyone else?
Option D, ma'am.
Option D. Fog computing is more powerful. Okay, anyone else?
Option A, ma'am.
Right, option A is correct. Fog computing acts as a complement to cloud computing. Basically, fog computing is going to provide the services which is provided by the cloud computing, but nearer to the end devices. Next question is, the OpenStack Cloud Simulation Framework provides an interactive interactive graphical user interface. True or false?
True.
Anyone else?
True.
Right, true. Next question is, virtualized resources within the OpenStack simulator that you can define, set parameters of, and deploy within OpenStack are also known as, options are instances, files, hypervisor, sketches.
Instances.
Anyone else?
Yes.
Right, it's instances. Next question is, if you want to connect your OpenStack instance with the external public network, you would need to connect the following between your instance and public network. Options are database, file, memory, router.
Router.
Anyone else? Yes, Correct option for this is router. Next question is, which among the following is not a part of sensor node connected to wireless sensor network? Options are sensing unit, gaming unit, processing unit, communication unit.
Gaming unit.
Option B is correct. Next question is, please mute yourself. Next question is, consider that you have two types of sensors, soil monitoring sensor for smart farming and temperature sensor for smart industry. The concept that correct type of sensor must be deployed only at the correct and appropriate physical location suitable as per the functionalities known as. Options are right way of deployment, right place of deployment, right time of deployment, none of these.
Right place of deployment.
Anyone else? Anyone else? No?
Option B.
Right, it's right place of deployment. Next question is, sensor as a service is an exciting new topic that brings the service model of cloud computing to traditional IoT sensor network. In this aspect, which among the following forms an essential component of sensor as a service architecture? Options are sensor marketing, sensor division, sensor virtualization, sensor manufacturing.
Sensor virtualization.
Anyone else? Yes, correct option for this is sensor virtualization. Next question is, considering the end-to-end architecture of WSN from the physical sensor node right up to the end user, sensor cloud support different entities to have ownership of different layers and components simultaneously. True or false?
True.
Anyone else? Yes, this statement is true. Next question is, in sensor cloud architecture, the sensor cloud service provider is logically situated at the following position of the architecture. Options are in the same level as the physical sensor, in between the physical sensor and the user layer, in the same level as the users, none of these.
Option B.
Option B. Okay, anyone else?
Option B.
Right, it's option B. So it is situated in between the physical sensor and the end users. Next question is, in sensor cloud, the association between virtual sensor instances and the corresponding physical sensor follows. Options are one-to-one mapping, one-to-many mapping, many-to-one mapping, many-to-many mapping.
Many-to-many mapping.
Anyone else? Anyone else? I'm repeating the question. In sensor cloud, the association between the virtual sensor instances and the corresponding physical sensor follows one-to-one mapping, one-to-many mapping, many-to-one mapping, many-to-many mapping.
One-to-many.
Anyone else? The correct option for this is many to many, because in case of sensor cloud, there might be a case that multiple physical sensors are used by multiple virtual sensors. Okay, multiple virtual sensors mean multiple applications are going to use multiple physical sensors, right? So it will be many to many. So many physical sensors to many virtual sensor instances. Next question is, dynamic caching mechanism improves the flexibility and efficiency of sensor cloud. True or false?
True.
Option A, ma'am.
Yes, it's option A. True. Next question is, with respect to caching based architecture of sensor cloud, the external cache has direct data connection with which of the following? Options are internal cache, user application, physical sensor, both physical sensor and internal cache.
Both physical sensors and internal cache.
Right, both physical sensor and internal cache. Next question is, data from an IoT device is transferred to cloud by network, which is then processed at the cloud, and then a response is sent back to the IoT device from the cloud after processing. The time it takes for one-way data transfer between the node and the cloud is 10 seconds. And the data processing time at the cloud is X second. It takes a total of 25 seconds for the entire to and fro transfer of data between the sensor and the cloud along with the processing at the cloud. What is the value of X? Options are 10 second, 5 second, 15 second, 20 second.
5 second.
Anyone else? Anyone else? Use that formula. Total time is equal to time to send the data, processing data, time to get back the data. So here total time is 25. To send and get back the data is 10. Now processing time you have to calculate. You just have to subtract only. Yeah, correct option for this is 5, because time one way time delay is 10 seconds, so round trip will be 20. So 20 plus X is equal to 25, X is equal to 25 minus 20, so it will be 5. Next question is, there are two types of sensor data, A and B. A is time sensitive, that is required to be processed immediately, while B is not time sensitive and can tolerate longer time for processing. As per the standard utilities of cloud and fog computing, which among the following options show correct processing location for A and B? A at cloud, B at fog, A at fog, B at cloud, none of these, both of these.
Option B.
Option B, ma'am.
Okay, anyone else? Yeah, correct option for this is B, because B is not time sensitive data, so it can be processed at cloud, and A is time sensitive, so it should be processed at fog. Next question is, there can be multiple fog nodes in between the physical sensor layer at the bottom and the cloud layer at the top. True or false?
True.
Option A.
Yes, it is true. Next question is, which among the following are potential problem and challenges in cloud computing? Options are power consumption, data security, liability, all the three.
All of these.
Anyone else?
Option D, ma'am.
Right, option D is correct. All of these. Next question is, OpenStack is a free open source software for cloud framework simulation and experimentation with various cloud application. True or false?
True.
Anyone else?
True.
Right, the statement is true. Sorry. Next question is, which among the following is not a component of OpenStack? Options are Horizon, Heat, Plasma, Neutron.
Plasma.
Anyone else? Correct option for this is Plasma. Next question is, you cannot ping your OpenStack instance from an outside network unless you connect your instance with the public network through a blank. Options are router, firewall, repeater, load balancer. This is
router.
Repeated.
Router.
Right, it is router. Next question is, virtualized resources within OpenStack simulator that you can define, set parameters of, and deploy within OpenStack are also known as instances, file, hypervisor, sketches. Again repeated.
Instances.
Right, it's instances. Next question is, the SCSP in sensor cloud is responsible for caching the data in the databases. True or false?
True.
Cool. Anyone else? Yes, it is true. Next question is,
Select the correct option for replacing the box. Where is box? I guess image is missing here. In the following architecture, okay. Yeah, this is the question. Select the correct options for replacing the box in the following architecture. So this is the architecture for sensor cloud organization view. So basically here what should be options are user credential, template display, template view, user view.
Template to display.
Anyone else? Option
B.
B, template display. Anyone else? It is option C, template view. Next question is, which among the following is the principal feature of sensor cloud with respect to sensor nodes? Options are sensor monitoring, sensor instantiation, sensor virtualization, sensor collection.
Sensor virtualization.
See. Right, sensor virtualization. Next question is, caching in sensor cloud provide no benefit over regions with slow environmental monitoring rate. True or false?
True.
Anyone else? This statement is false. Next caching in sensor cloud provide no benefit over regions with slow environmental. It should be true. No region with slow environmental. This should be true. It is not false. So this question is wrong. Let me check, correct it here only. Next is, how many different types of caching mechanism are there in sensor cloud? Options are 1, 4, 2, 3.
2.
Right, it's 2. Internal and external. Next question is, virtual sensor within a sensor cloud have communication interfaces with blank. Options are only the physical sensor below them, only the end user application above them, both sensor and applications, neither physical sensor nor application.
Option C.
Right, it's option C. Next question is, this is a repeated question, so I'm skipping this. In IoT, temporal sensitivity of data plays an important role. True or false?
True.
Anyone else? Yes, this statement is true. Next question is, extremely time sensitive data in IoT should be processed and analyzed. Blank. Options are farthest away from the source, closest to the source, distance between source and place of analysis does not matter. None of these.
Option B.
Anyone else?
Option B, ma'am.
Right, it's option B. Next question is, which among the following is a view of fog computing architecture? Options are node view, system view, software view, all of these.
Option E.
Option E. Anyone else? Correct option is all of these. Next question is, which among the following is true? Options are fog computing act as a complement to cloud computing. B is fog computing is replacement
option
of cloud.
A.
Right, it is option A,
option
repeated
A.
Question. Fog computing act as a complement of cloud computing. Next question is, OpenStack is a free open source software for cloud framework simulation and experimentation with various cloud applications. True or false?
True.
Right, this statement is true. Next question is, which component of OpenStack do you use to access all the other components? Options are Origin, Glass, Neutron, none of these.
Horizon.
Which one? Repeat, please.
Horizon.
Okay, anyone else?
Glass.
Anyone else?
It is Origin. Next question is, which among the following is not a component of OpenStack? Repeated question.
Plasma,
right. Next question is, sensor cloud is simply dumping and organizing of sensor data on cloud computing platform. True or false?
False.
Right, this statement is false. Next question is, which among the following are limitation of traditional wireless sensor networks? Options are procurement issue, deployment issue, maintenance issues, all of these.
All of these.
Right, all of these. Next question is, in a typical sensor cloud architecture, the sensor cloud infrastructure that provides the virtualization lies blank. Options are at same layer as physical sensor devices, at the application layer, in between physical and application layer. Sensor cloud does not support virtualization.
Option C.
Option C.
Anyone else? Yes, correct option for this is option C. Next question is, generally speaking, sensor cloud service providers are also always the owners of physical sensor. Yes or no?
No.
Anyone else?
No.
Are also always the owner. This should be no. Generally speaking, sensor cloud service provider are also always the owner of physical sensor. This is no. Next question is, in a typical sensor cloud architecture with virtualization, one virtual sensor can be associated with how many physical sensors? Options are only one, one or more than one, none, only two.
Option B.
One or more.
Yes, it's option B, one or more than one. Next question is, sensor virtualization aims to achieve more blank in providing sensor-based services. Complexity.
Flexibility.
Right, it's flexibility. Next question is this repeated? No. Suppose that you want to start a business to provide some IoT based application, but you do not have means to develop the application layer logic. Neither you have the means to purchase and deploy a physical sensor. You can, however, rent cloud servers for use and write interface logic for interfacing with the other modules. Which among the following actors will be the most suitable for you? Options are physical sensor owner, application layer developer, sensor cloud service provider. You cannot start the business.
Option
okay.
C.
Option C, ma'am.
Okay, anyone else? It is option C. Next question is, which among the following is implemented along with the sensor cloud to make its services and performances better? Options are caching, basically the caching spellings are different, caching, calling.
Option B.
Right, it's option B. Next question is, which among the following cases is most likely to reduce the overall price of sensor cloud implementation, provided that the data traverses through multiple sensor hops, starting from the origin sensor to sync node, and provided that all the owners are honest and charges for only what is required? Options are, if physical sensors are owned by multiple owners with high profit margin. B is, if all physical sensors are owned by single owner with uniform profit margin. Anyone?
Option A.
Anyone else?
Option A, man.
It should be option B, because if it is owned by only a single owner with uniform profit margin, then there will be better scenario. Next question is, fog computing is aimed to replace cloud computing completely and has no scope for integration with cloud.
False.
Right, this is false. Next question is, suppose
data from an IoT device first goes to fog layer for some basic processing, after which it goes to cloud layer for advanced processing, and then the processed data comes back to the fog layer and then finally comes back to the origin of sensor node. In the return journey, no processing of data take place anywhere, just transfer of data take place. If TF is the time taken by the data to travel from the sensor to fog and vice versa, and TC is the time taken by the data to travel from the fog to cloud and vice versa, TFP is the data processing time at the fog and TCP is the data processing time at the cloud, what is the total round trip time T taken by the data starting from the origin sensor node, processing the data and then back to the sensor node after being processed? Options are: A is T is equal to TF plus TC plus TFP plus TCP, B is T is equal to TF plus TC, C is T is equal to 2 times TF plus TC plus TFP plus TCP, D is 4 times TF plus TC plus TFP plus TCP.
Option C.
Right, it is option C. Next question is, consider the standard fog computing architecture. In which of the following layer will very sensitive data be processed? Option is nearest fog node, distance, aggregate fog node, cloud, does not matter.
Option A.
Anyone else? Yes, it is option A. Next question is, network, accelerator, compute and storage constitute the part of which view of fog computing architecture as defined by Open Fog Consortium Architecture Working Group? Options are system view, node view, software view, none of these.
System view.
Anyone else? It is node view. Yeah, so these were the questions of week 9. Now let me share this PDF with you. I have shared the link of folder. It contains all the PDFs, Ramya CN. So all the PDFs from week 1 to week 9. I have uploaded week 9 as well. Do you need the recording of previous session as well? Let me share that as well with you. I have shared YouTube link as well as the PDF. Any question now? If there is no question, then I'm terminating the session. Can everyone please confirm whether
you have any doubt or not. Alka?
Yes.
Do you have any question?
No.
Okay. Okay, you may leave now then. Any other? Anyone else who have any question? Okay, then I'm terminating the session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Okay.